Good evening, everybody. I would like to thank IMA Forum Bakum for having me here to meet you all and discuss about the recent advances in hernia surgery. Like any other field in medicine, as medicine is advancing, each and every field advances, so does the field of hernia surgery also, because hernia being such a common condition, such a common problem, now we have moved off a lot of open techniques and moving into more of laparoscopic work. So evolution is happening, and evolution in hernia surgeries, we started with the herniographies spoken by Scholtes and Besney, and then we went to the tension-free repair by using a prosthetic mesh, which is the Leichenstein, which is still done in great numbers. Not that it is anything wrong with the technique, but as we evolve, we find better techniques for better patient outcome. Now, earlier we used to think laparoscopy was all about cosmesis, where the incision size is smaller, where we make it was promoted as keyhole surgery. But it's not only about the cosmesis, but it is also when we find that it is giving better results in terms of patient compliance and patient satisfaction, and most importantly, reduction of recurrence rates of hernias. As we know, hernial recurrence is theoretically a possibility in every surgeon's hand, but we as surgeons make as much as possible to try to reduce that recurrence rate. And that's how laparoscopy became more and more used. As we go in my talk, we will be able to understand as to why laparoscopy and other techniques are coming into fashion. So, as you see, all this alphabets here, all these things are the recent ones. We will go in detail. Okay. So, it's not only about the technique which has changed, but commercially, there are a lot of meshes that are available. Now, the dictum is that we do mesh repair for all hernia patients. There is no area where we just do a raphe, but only exception being in an infected state, we do not use the prosthetic mesh. But otherwise, there are a whole array of meshes available. The most common mesh that we still use is the simple age-old polypropylene mesh. That is good, that is cheap, and that is best. Especially when you are talking about a cost-concerned community like ours, for polypropylene meshes are the best. There is polyester meshes, there are partially absorbable meshes. Now all these meshes give a sort of a lighter mesh load to the patient, so their post-operative feel of the mesh is considerably lesser. Now there is this mesh which is a non-absorbable mesh with the barrier. Now when we are talking about laparoscopic repair of ventral hernias, laparoscopic repair of umbilical and incisional hernias, epigastric hernias, we have to put the mesh on the parietal peritoneum. So this parietal peritoneum is in touch with the bowel. So we want a barrier to prevent bowel adhesion to the mesh. So there are each company has their own strengths. One comes with PTFE, polyurethane, omega-3 fatty acids, collagen. Every company will say, sir, mine is the best, mine is the best, mine is better, superior than, mine is superior than. But finally, time tested, is collagen, PTFE, which is good. There are also, now that we have got this, biological meshes. Biological meshes are collagen extracts from human or animal base. The cellular content alone is, which is the immunogenic content alone is taken away, and only the collagen is taken, and the biological meshes are available. Of course, they are very, very expensive, and their only role is in an infected case. Again, based on the weight, there are heavyweight meshes, lightweight meshes. There are self-clipping. Self-clipping meaning we just have to place the mesh. We don't have to suture the meshes. There are dual layer meshes. The one thing which I missed is a 3D mesh. When you are doing laparoscopic surgery, the 3D mesh it conforms to the anatomical orientation of that myopectinal orifice. So again, that mesh is again on the more expensive side. So this is the, just to give an anatomical orientation of what we do. So this is the bowel, which is entering the deep ring, inguinal canal, and popping out through the superficial inguinal ring. Now, usually, age old, what we have been doing is placing the mesh here at the level of the at the inguinal canal. But in laparoscopy, the mesh is placed pre-peritoneally, that is the peritoneum is dissected just in front of the fascia transversalis, between the fascia transversalis and the peritoneum, a mesh is placed. Now, there is a reason why I have specifically put such a long yellow line and here a very small one. That is typically to denote the kind of size of mesh that we can use when we are doing laparoscopic work. This mesh, the amount of area that we get during laparoscopic repair, there is no way that sort of cover we can give in an open inguinal hernia repair, because the inguinal canal is only that size. We can maximum put a 6 into 3 centimeter mesh, and that's all we can get with an open Leydig stent. Not that it is bad, again there are better techniques, that's what I am here to tell. So this is a large, the usual size of mesh that we use compared to a 6 into 3 centimeter mesh. Now in laparoscopy we use a 15 into 12 centimeter mesh. So this is a video to show how laparoscopic hernia we do. Now this approach is called totally, the technique is totally extraperitoneal, but this is a transabdominal approach. So where we enter the abdomen, just like any other laparoscopic surgery, and we create peritoneal flaps. Once we create this peritoneal flap, we enter the preperitoneal plane. Now that preperitoneal plane is a surgeon's playground. It's the best space. If you ask me as a lover of hernia surgery, it is the best space to operate. It's full of loose areola tissue. All you have to do is blunt dissection. We can see the sac which is entering the deep ring here. So the sac is dissected. Just like any other, the principles of hernia surgery is the same for laparoscopy and open. So the dissection is done, the sac is completely reduced. What we see, this white structure here is the vas deferens along with the part structures. So you can see the sac is completely dissected, and that is a lipoma of the part that has also been dissected out completely. And this is the preperitoneal space and on both sides. We have done a bilateral preperitoneal repair, and on both sides can appreciate it's all one cavity. So the mesh is placed inside. This is a simple polypropylene mesh. Earlier we used to have this company guys coming and saying that 3D mesh is that is this mesh 3D mesh is only for laparoscopic hernia work. But simple meshes will do. Of course, when we are doing a trans-abdominal approach, the peritoneum has to be closed back because we do not want this polypropylene mesh to come in touch with the bowel whatsoever. So during a trans-abdominal approach, it is very, very mandatory that we make sure to give to re-peritonealize the mesh. The other way of pre-peritoneal approach is totally extra-peritoneal. What we do is we do not enter the abdomen, we just go in the pre-peritoneal plane. So how we enter, so we, again initially it was taught to us that this pre-peritoneal plane creation is a very, very difficult technique. We never commercially available balloons. So this is the pre-peritoneal plane. So this trocar with the balloon is inserted into the pre-peritoneal plane and the balloon is inflated. Once you inflate the balloon, the space opens up. But now with simple just camera dissection, the pre-peritoneal plane is open. All you have to do is open the anterior rectus, push the muscle to the side and go into the pre-peritoneal space, and the gas that we use itself will dissect. We do not have to do anything. So once we have enough space, the first working trocar comes in, and this is the loose areola tissue. Basic energy source is more than enough. All we have to do is just use a monopolar or a bipolar cutter. We do not use any other fancy energy sources at all. So spaces are created mainly in the all the way up to the pubic symphysis and laterally up to the level of the anterior superior iliac spine, where we have the second working trocar. With that second working trocar, as you see, with obviously with two hands, the sac dissection is done. This is a right hernia. You can see the back of the pubic bone. That is the pseudo sac which is going in. This is the sac which we have dissected down. Just by blunt dissection, all these are possible. We don't need to do any hard dissection here. You can see the vas turn medially, and that's the place where we stop our dissection. So that is the direct hernia. This area is the place where we have the inferior epigastric. The medial to that is the defect. So these are tackers that we use to just fix the mesh. Of course, we don't really need to use tackers. We can just plain do an intracorporeal suturing. But sometimes we surgeons are a little bit lazy. We just have a plug there and it just come out. So this is what we do regularly now for inguinal hernias. When we are talking about ventral hernias, that is a whole different ballgame. Not one hernia is the same for every other patient that we operate. So this illustration is just to show the different areas that we can place a mesh. Earlier what we used to do is, this is the anterior rectus sheath, this is the rectus muscle, this is the posterior rectus sheath, and this is the peritoneum. So usually, age old, what we have been doing is to keep the, close the defect of course, and keep the mesh on the anterior rectus sheath. But now, during laparoscopic ventral hernia repair, we keep a mesh on the peritoneum. That is what I was talking to you about, the different types of meshes. So the most recent advance in ventral hernia is the placement of mesh in the retromuscular space, that is just above the posterior rectus sheath and below the rectus muscle. This again is a diagram to show where all we can keep. This is what we do normally. Anterior to the anterior rectus sheath, we place the mesh. This is a plug mesh plug, that is, we don't really use it nowadays, but just for completion's sake, that is, mesh plugs are available, but it is not caught on much. This was the retromuscular repair that I was talking about, and this is the intraperitoneal meshes. So this is a view, internal view of ventral hernia. So this patient was a, I think BMI 40, had two periumbilical defects. So we're just doing a simple adhesiolysis and reducing the contents from both the defects. So here the plan was to do an intraperitoneal mesh. Earlier, again, while keeping intraperitoneal meshes, there was the recommendation was that you just place the mesh and you come out, you don't have to really close the defect. But now this procedure is called IPOM plus, IPOM meaning intraperitoneal onlay mesh plus, meaning we don't just leave these defects are very small defects, however we make sure that these defects are closed before we put the mesh. What do we do in an open technique? We close the defect and put the mesh. The same thing must be done. That's the principle of hernia surgery repair. So the same thing is done in laparoscopy also. And this is a special suture that we use. It's called the barred suture. It's more easy when you're doing a laparoscopic repair to do this, to use this particular suture. Now this is the mesh. Now this mesh is an intraperitoneal mesh. This side is polypropylene, the one facing the abdomen. Now this side, that one facing the bowel, is an inert material. Now this was very new in the market actually. This is an inflatable balloon that just holds up the mesh so that it makes packing very easy. So we put two rows of tackers. Yes, again, this can be done by suturing also. If the tacking is going to cost for the patient, we can also do a suture closure. Once the tacking is done, this balloon is just removed through one of the ports. And that's the view. Now this is another umbilical hernia, very small defect. So what we did here was, we did something called a scola. Okay, scola is an endoscopic onlay anterior repair. So adhesiolysis was done in transabdominally, and through a small incision we create this plane. This is the sheet that you see now is the anterior rectus. Just like doing open surgery, the same thing, the planes are created laparoscopically. This is the umbilical tuck that you can see, umbilical pillar. So it's geared all around. And of course this was an umbilical hernia. So we are opening up the hernial sac. Here we must take care that we don't injure the umbilicus per se. It's very easy to just use this instrument and just have a bite on the umbilicus. So we take care and the defect is opened up. We don't have to be worried about any content itself because we are going already on intraperitoneal to make sure that content is not there. So the defect is sutured, of course using polypropylene sutures. This conforms to any open technique, any open principle. The defect is closed, and following this, we place the mesh. In this particular space, the mesh has to be fixed properly. Mesh is fixed. Just like open surgery, the mesh is also fixed, and of course we Post-operatively, the patient will have two drains coming out through this wound. And again, because we detach the umbilicus must be reattached. This is another same scola procedure. Again, you can appreciate the amount of space that has been created here. So, in this, we can dissect all the way up to just subxiphoid and go laterally from 15 to 16 centimeters. Now, what we're marking is this patient had a divarication of rectus. So we just mark the edges of the rectus muscle, and then the plication also can be done laparoscopically. So the plication is done, and then same thing, the mesh is placed, and now coming to complex hernias, what is complex? Complex is large recurrent hernias but following multiple surgeries, infected cases, parastomal hernias, hernias in OBs, all these comes under complex hernias. Now earlier the only option that we had was to just reduce the entire thing in mass, put a mesh and come out. But again, the chances of recurrence was very, very high. So in this motive to reduce the recurrence rates and to bring about closure and to bring about good abdomen wall functionality was this Reed Stopa technique. So here what we do is this, I'm sorry for the bad images. What the anus is holding is the posterior rectus sheath. You can see the rectus muscle. So this is what I was talking about, the retromuscular repair, retrorectal repair. So this is the posterior rectus sheath, this is the rectus muscle, and this layer that you see is the anterior rectus. So what we have done is, we have done a midline closure of the posterior rectus sheath. We have kept a mesh beneath the muscle, and on top of this, we will have a central closure of the linear alba. So what it gives is, it gives the hernia is taken care, the recurrence rate, we have put in a mesh, and then the third thing is the patient functionality is also very good because we are recreating the linear alba, not just pushing the entire thing and closing it en masse. Now the same thing can be done laparoscopically again. Yes, it is time consuming to do this sort of kind of dissection laparoscopically involving the entire abdomen. It will take at least close to 4 to 5 hours, but it is definitely worth it at the end of the day. So the same concept, Reed Stopa done laparoscopically, is called ETEP. ETEP is only but extended transportally extraperitoneal repair, where we place the camera high up in the upper abdomen. This is the left hypochondrium, the camera is placed. This procedure, this technique can be used even for large inguinal hernias and ventral hernia repair as well. Now this is a little bit long video. Let me just
mesh is placed.
Large mesh, large size mesh is placed and the entire thing is done laparoscopically.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
You have done a very good presentation. Very nice. I'm very happy to hear from you. But you kindly tell this audience, what are the contraindications of laparoscopic hernia repair? Number one. Second thing is, one more technical thing I would like to contradict you. When you mentioned about the IPOM repair, everywhere, both outer crowning as well as inner crowning, you used Thacker. At least there should be about 4 or 5 sutures which go completely, full length, full thickness of the abdominal muscle. Of course, that is a technical detail, but I would like to tell the audience, what are the contraindications where you will not do laparoscopic repair?
Sir, right,
it is not a panacea for everything. It's not a must, it's like, it's not a gold standard like...
It's not gold standard, yes, sir.
So where you will not do, I think it will tell, it will be better.
Sir, laparoscopy per se, right now our contraindication is if the patient is medically unfit, if the patient will not take the changes in the body homeostasis following the pneumo encephalation, those patients we will not venture in laparoscopy. Any other patient, we can do laparoscopy. Again, cost was an issue, but now again, lap hernias are as expensive as open hernias. There is no real difference in that. Earlier, cost was an issue, logistics was an issue, but now all that has been sorted out and it's all standardized. So my only contraindication will be to medically unfit patients, yes.
Yes, sir. You have not showed how the mesh has integrated with the body at the end of 5 years follow-up, 10 years follow-up. What is your experience?
Sir, intraperitoneal meshes, one is very expensive. When you are talking about polypropylene mesh, 15x15 mesh is about 1,500 to 2,000 rupees. But the same thing, 15x15 intraperitoneal mesh costs somewhere around 25,000 rupees, number one. For that 25,000 rupees, again, the company claims that there is zero additions. It is not true. We have had cases where we have had to remove, because we have had to go back inside and remove meshes just because of additions, adhesive folate and all those things. So intraperitoneal meshes, yes, there is a high chance of additions, but there is a corollary to it. But the chance of this additions causing symptomatic problem to the patient is less than about 5%. So hence, intraperitoneal meshes are still being popularized and we are still doing. With respect to other laparoscopic procedures, where we are in a extra peritoneal thing, we do not find any sort of additions. It integrates very, very well in the body, but we will not be able to go back inside and see that plane, because that plane is going to be completely engulfed with fibrosis caused by the mesh. So, for your question, I can say that 5 years down the lane or 10 years down the lane, what this mesh does is only with respect to intraperitoneal meshes we'll be able to know, because intraperitoneally we will might have to go back inside for whatever other issues. Yes, there are additions, but they are very seldom symptomatic to the patients.
But just to find out what happens to that mesh, we can't do another surgery 5 years from now. Suppose I've done a case today. After 5 years, you have to find out whether the mesh has integrated or not. As long as the patient is absolutely asymptomatic, you are happy. Otherwise, you will have to go back and then do a laparoscopy, which involves anesthesia, medical opinion, everything. You know? Unnecessarily, we will be subjecting a patient to surgery on mere suspicion. There is no method, but I don't know whether Dr. Sai may be able to say. whether there are radiologically, whether radiologically you can find out whether there is a mesh integration. Because in 5 years time, what happens is the mesh gets completely integrated with the rest of the tissue, but they may be able to identify the difference in the echogenicity.
High resolution ultrasound, when you do it, we can see that any folding of that mesh and any collection, infected one, that one only, that much only we can say, sir. But the integration, you cannot make it.
Even in ultrasound, you cannot.
No, only mesh is.
Integrated with the body.
Yeah, that's right.
Because we have done cases where a lady become pregnant after the hernia repair, and then we have to do a cesarean section. In that case, you go through the mesh. That time it will be only when cut edges you will be able to see the serration. You will not be able to. You will find it a little difficult. But just to find out what is happening to the mesh, I don't think anyone does it.
Mesh is as it is, or it is disintegrated.
No, it will get integrated with the body. That is, as you said, the inner layer, because when we do a laparoscopic surgery for an abdominal hernia, what happens is we keep a dual mesh. That is, it is two. There is one on the surface of the abdominal muscle is the proline mesh, by and large, or a Teflon mesh, which will not disintegrate. It remains, but it gets integrated with the body. The other layer, that's why it is called as dual mesh. The other layer is the collagen or some other material which will get absorbed over a period of 2 weeks or 4 weeks, so that the bubble doesn't get adherent to the proline. So it is a dual mesh that we keep for all intra-abdominal surgeries that we show. That is that. So, and then that is supposed to be a protective layer. And I think we have come a long way. Many patients want it, and then we do it. And then it makes a lot of difference. Because even if the patient, one advantage of laparoscopic hernia is, even if the patient coughs, the mesh will only get pushed towards the muscle. You understand? Cough or any respiratory problem will not increase the hernia size. In fact, it will adhere to the defect more and more with every act of strain. But only thing is, before surgery, if the patient is having respiratory problem, it will be very, the patient has to be fit. Respiratory tract wise, it should be fit. Cardiovascular site wise, it should be fit. Otherwise, it is the idea.
Thank you. Our call, Dr. Vasanta, to hand over the certificate.